Hello, and thank you for joining us for today's session. Is your organization ready and prepared to combat the next cyber attack? The webinar is part of our Lutheran Services in America Strength and Service series, which is really focused on identifying and seizing opportunities in today's uncertain climate, all with the goal of helping your organization thrive. We're pleased to have the webinar in partnership with the Lutheran Financial Managers Association, LFMA, and are glad that so many members can join us today, including Bob Wydra, the CFO from Lutheran Services Florida and chair of the LFMA. Bob, do you want to say a few words?
Sure. Thanks, Charlotte. I appreciate the introduction. Hello, everybody. As Charlotte said, I'm Bob Wydra, CFO of Lutheran Services Florida, and we're one of the larger social service Lutheran organizations in the country. And last year I attended this this session with Alexandra, and it was so compelling for us that it prompted us to make a switch. And we switched over to Alexandra and JKJ with our cyber renewal policy, and it made a world of difference for us. It was a very proactive approach. We dug into specific IT applications and worked closely with Alexandra and her team to review the upcoming renewal way ahead of time. We implemented three different types of things: multi-factor authentication, endpoint detection responses, as well as air gapping our backup remote or our backup logs, et cetera, and all in an effort to be able to secure cyber insurance again this year without a huge increase. And we probably invested around 50 to 60,000 in IT upgrades and new types of software, et cetera, but saved a significant amount of anticipated premium increase. And in fact, we ended up with better coverage over the course of the year, and our premiums only went up by 10 grand. So we went from 48,000 to 58,000 and are in a much better, secure, safe environment, and we're not worried about renewing on an annual basis now that we've done that. And I've never worked with a broker that was more adept at understanding cyber insurance than JKJ. So it's a plug I wanted to throw out there that I just took advantage of this same call last year, reached out to Alexandra, and it made a world of difference for us. So I hope you all avail yourselves the opportunity to do so and see how they can help. Charlotte, I'll turn it back to you.
Great. So I'm pleased to introduce our speakers today from Johnson Kendall Johnson. First, our good friend, Raphael Hachisi, who's the Vice President of JKJ, along with Alexander Brett Schneider, President and Cyber Practice Leader at JFK. They are both at the top, and I mentioned they have a great and informative webinar this year, a request for updated information number. And is a insurance brokerage and risk management firm. What I'd like to do now is turn it over to them, and please feel free to put your questions in the chat box. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Charlotte. Appreciate the introduction. And Bob, I think we can just stop the session right now based upon what he said. Just call Alexandra and everything will be fine, right? No, no, that's great. My name is Raphael Hachisi. I'm with Johnson Kendall Johnson, along with Alexander Brett Schneider, who you'll meet in a second. And again, we really do appreciate the partnership that we have with Lutheran Services in America. And Charlotte, again, congratulations on the big announcement. We're looking forward to hearing about all the great things that you've done and are doing and will do as you start the transition from LSA. So congratulations again. We'll go quick here a little bit about JKJ very briefly. As Bob actually mentioned, we do pride ourselves on being extremely proactive when it comes to what an insurance broker does. We find that a lot of brokers are simply transactional. You meet him or her right before the renewal, are presented with the renewal options or option, and then the renewal takes place, and then we'll talk to you next year. That's not how JKJ does business. We actually have a much more hands-on approach where we're providing services throughout the policy year, be it from the cyber standpoint, from liability, loss control, safety standpoint, workers' comp, whatever is needed for the clients, we will provide from a risk management standpoint. And we like to use that term outsourced risk management department. When you work with JKJ, you gain a department of professionals who become an extension of your organization from a risk management standpoint. We are based in Newtown, PA, which is a little bit outside of Philadelphia, which makes us nice and centrally located between Washington, New York, and also, you know, going further south down into the Floridas. Lately, as you can see, we've been really kind of focusing more on industry. As you see here, we work with over 225 senior living communities, as well as about 50 plus human service organizations across 20 plus states, where most brokers typically do like a geographical approach. JKJ does an industry approach. We become the industry professionals within that silo who just happen to be the insurance geeks. And a little known trivia fact, I think we've mentioned this in the past, our financial services group back in the late 70s, early 80s, discovered the 401k loophole, and our 401k account number is actually 00001. We were the first ones to do that. So I'm going to kick it back to Alexandra real quick, and she can introduce herself, and then we'll get this show on the road.
Thank you, Raf, and thank you all for having me back today. This is so exciting. And hello to those of you that may be listening to this as the recorded version. Bob, thank you so much for the kind words. I'm so, you know, delighted that you had such a positive experience and that it really actually started with this exact type of webinar. So I did go back in time and make sure I looked at my slides from last year and refreshed everything. I wanted to not do too much repetitive, and I wanted to keep this really fresh and new. So if any of you did participate last year, there should be a lot of new nuggets that you'll get out of that conversation today. I'm going to move pretty quickly. We have a lot of slides and you will get a copy of these. We are monitoring the chat. We have a little bit of a tighter knit group today. Listen, Raf and I have done this a million times. I'm sick of hearing myself talk. I would love nothing more than for one of you to chime in with a question, a thought, anything at all. You're not interrupting us, please, at any point. That said, we're going to push you for a little bit of engagement. So Raf has a couple of questions that we're going to ask, and we really want you guys to get engaged. So this is for you, not for us. My background, the reason why we're a little bit unique when it comes to the whole cyber risk and cyber insurance space is that I actually have an IT consulting background, and most brokers do not. So I started my career in IT consulting at Ernst & Young in their IT advisory practice. I then went on and did some telecom consulting before finding my way into the insurance world a little over 7 years ago. So cyber is the most comfortable thing for me. I then obtained a designation through Carnegie Mellon that they came up with a couple of years ago, yada, yada. Created our cyber practice, and I am so delighted to share we won Broker of the Year last year, 2021. And that's because we've really committed ourselves to the space. We do a ton in terms of coverage reviews, benchmarking data, resources, risk management resources in terms of tabletop exercise. We'll do educational resources, network scans, et cetera. So there's a lot of things we have access to that we can help you with.
Thanks, Alexandra. So let's go into the agenda real quick, just what we'll be covering today. So we'll be focusing obviously on the latest trends. And really that's from both your perspective as the provider, as the service community, but also from the perspective of the underwriting community, from the insurance market. I'm sure you've heard over the last 18 months, the market has been turned upside down, especially when it comes to cyber. And so Alexandra will be going over those latest trends. We also want to talk about the risk management tactics. What are the things we're doing to put us best in class? You know, Bob mentioned sort of the stuff that had to be done before the renewal took place so that they were compliant with the insurance carrier's requirements. So what are we doing from a risk management standpoint to stay ahead of the game? Obviously, there are some regulatory and insurance changes that are happening right now, both from the regulatory standpoint, also from our standpoint, the insurance coverage. You know, what exclusionary language is being included or not included in those policies? What do we need to look for in our own cyber policy to make sure that the cyber coverage that we're buying is actually going to protect us? And then finally, the playbook of incident response. You know, what is it that we're doing during the policy year to continually remind our employees that cyber is an exposure that we need to be aware of and we need to be staying ahead of when it comes to all the bad things that could happen from a cyber perspective? You know, Bob mentioned during his introduction there that he met with us for our session last year, which was, I believe, in July also, and immediately got in touch with us. And kudos to him for doing that, because his renewal is not until June. which meant he was contacting us with 11 months to go for the next renewal. And to be honest with you, that is what we need right now. You need that runway or as much of a runway as you can provide so that we can stay ahead of the next insurance renewal. What you'll find is that the underwriting community, the insurance carriers have started to get a little more scrutinous when it comes to the questions that are being asked during the renewal process. You know, heads of IT are now being part of the discussion during renewal. They're being questioned with regards to the protocols that they're putting into place and what they plan to do from a strategic standpoint. We'll focus on what your biggest cybersecurity fears are. And as Alexandra mentioned, feel free to use the chat room. We have a small group here, which is great. So we can really make this a little bit more back and forth as possible. So feel free to shoot whatever chat features you want in there as far as, you know, cybersecurity fears, issues, what you went through in your last renewal, and also what challenges are you experiencing as an organization when it comes to figuring out those cybersecurity issues. We know that the hackers are getting a lot more intelligent when it comes to how they're getting into your organization. And at the same time, the insurance market is getting a lot more intelligent as well as they come in and scan your websites even before you've submitted the application to start the renewal process. So think about these things as sort of food for thought as we go through, and feel free to throw in any questions or comments as we go along and we'll monitor them. So let's jump into the first issue du jour. Alexandra?
Yeah, I would also say too, if anybody has anything specifically they want me to make sure I cover today, feel free to throw that in there as well.
Yep, that sounds good. Sounds good. So yeah, so let's go into the latest trends and I'll let you take it from here.
Yeah, so first two slides are actually pretty similar to what we went through last year. And it's just as a reminder, right? When we talk about cyber incidents, some of the big things that come to mind are ransomware attacks and data breaches, but there are more to it than that, right? So various types of phishing attacks that could result in the theft of money or information. Even a stolen laptop could qualify as a potential cyber incident. Issues with vendors, their own errors and their negligence. If someone walked into your building and stole a filing cabinet full of medical records, the physical loss of that, the tangible data that's on paper, would still qualify as a cyber incident in terms of where it would trigger coverage. It's a privacy type of incident. So it does go a little bit beyond what we think of first and foremost of what we're seeing in the news every day. Now, we talked a little bit actually just before we all hopped on together about technology advancement. It is a beautiful, wonderful thing, right? We want to get more efficient, better, faster, stronger. And so we use technology to do that. And we incorporate that into our lives, our personal lives, and our professional lives. And so the more we connect to the internet, the more it creates that exposure for what is cyber risk. And then ultimately, at this point in time, they're projecting cybercrime, if it continues at the rate that it has, to cost the world $10.5 trillion annually by 2025. It is already considered one of the largest economies in the world. In terms of trends, right, we've seen this slide before. So kind of data breaches dominated the news for the long time. They still do. Social engineering attacks are something we're very familiar with now, right? We're always getting those scamming emails, and unfortunately, sometimes we fall suspect to them. But social engineering can come in many different forms. It can be an email. It could be a phone call. It could technically be somebody knocking on your company's door. It just means that they're trying to engineer an attack against you using your own social prejudices, right? Your desire to help, your thought that they're someone that they're not who they say they are, any of those things. And those are still happening an extraordinary amount today. So I know in the chat here, we have a couple of things going back and forth between Bob and Raf about ransomware still being one of the biggest concerns. But I will tell you, across JKJ's client base at this point in time, social engineering attacks are still the most prevalent attack that we experience. So ransomware is a major concern, but social engineering is pretty extraordinary still as well.
And then, interesting, of course, piece, yeah, I was just going to say, along with social engineering, is that they're getting a lot smarter because, as you've seen, these hackers now will go into the system, sit there and watch the traffic and see the calendar of the Bob Weirders of the world and say, oh, look, it looks like Bob is at a dentist office this afternoon. So I'm going to send an email that says, I, Bob, am at the dentist office. Please release the funds ASAP. You know, we haven't seen that before. And the hackers are getting a little bit more personalized when it comes to, you know, tweaking the information that they have so that they can get access to the data they need.
And then One of the pieces we were talking about too is there are still a few folks, but it's much farther, fewer and farther between now, that don't believe cyber risk still pertains to them. And there's a quote that I just love that I think really summarizes it perfectly. It's not that they're targeting you specifically. Ransomware gangs traditionally don't actually care about you and your data. You care about you and your data and your ability to operate. That's what they're exploiting. It's not just you personally, it's your desire and need to operate, to maintain privacy and all of those things. Now, a few quick numbers updates, and then we're going to go through some of the results from 2021. So in 2020, right, ransomware was off the charts. So it was for the first time it actually hit six figures on average of payouts. 2021 comes around, we hit average extortion demands for the first half of the year were over $500 million. I'm sorry, half a million dollars, I should say, sorry, $500,000. Now that average was really driven up by some of the large attacks that you may remember. Colonial Pipeline, CNA paid out $44 million. JBS Meatpacking paid out $11 million. So it really brought that average up. It ended up in the year a little bit closer to $250,000, but still over $100,000 now in losses. It's still predicted to this day that businesses are being attacked every 11 seconds. The average downtime when you suffer an attack, and I will tell you, this holds true. I live these with our clients, and this is not an exaggerated number, is 19 to 23 days of you working to resolve that attack. So we love technology and we always expect it to work so quickly, right? So we think of it as a resolution. We should be able to spin up our backups quickly. We should be able to decrypt files quickly. And unfortunately, there's extraordinary processing time that's involved in those things. But even before you get to that, and we're gonna talk a little bit about this in terms of what incident response looks like, there's a lot of time involved in investigation and making sure we understand what happened, how it happened, and what we need to do next. An interesting thing that happened in 2021, a little different than 2020, is now zero-day exploits doubled. That's a very fancy way of saying hackers compromising software vulnerabilities doubled. Now, that's a scary statistic because that's something we have limited control over, right? We didn't write the code that goes into the software that we're using. The piece we have control over is when they issue a patch, how quickly do we deploy that? So these were known vulnerabilities that were then getting exploited and people were not patching them timely. So it's really important to make sure you have good patching protocols, and we'll touch on that a few times. But that became the next biggest attack, and we'll see that again in some data in a minute. I know people sometimes like a little bit of scary stories just to know what types of things are happening, but extortions continued to get a little bit more sophisticated. So years ago with the ransomware attack, it used to be they just locked up your system and you paid them to get the key back. Well, then we got better and we said, hey, we're going to have good backups in place so that we don't have to pay. I don't need to pay you. I'll just use my backups and we're going to make sure they're separate and that you didn't compromise them. So they said, okay, not only am I going to lock you up, I'm also going to steal your data. I'll exfiltrate it. And then you're going to pay me because otherwise I'll release it. So a lot of ransoms are still paid from that threat. Well, they've gone even further at times. They will actually potentially pick up the phone and call your employees or your clients because they have that information and say, hey, I have so-and-so's network encrypted or so-and-so's data. And if they don't pay me, I'm releasing your information. So imagine getting a call from someone you serve saying, hey, I just got a call from an attacker that said they have my information because of you. You will be much more likely to pay to get this incident resolved and put it to bed, right? That's the incentive there. They're going to harass. And then there was incidents of print bombing. That's where they actually send the ransom note to your printer at your office just to prove they're in there, right? To add that layer of fear into the equation that's only aimed at making you more likely to pay. As a result of the types of major ransoms paid out, the ones I mentioned, SolarWinds, Colonial Pipeline, CNA Insurance, JBS, et cetera, multi-million dollar payouts, We've certainly gotten the government's attention. Not only have they been compromised as part of these attacks, but there's a lot of dollars now going out the door and funding continued cybercrime. So we're going to talk a little bit more too about what's happening from a regulatory perspective. I'm going to flip through the next few slides pretty quickly. And again, you're going to get a copy of these. All of this data is from the two top forensics firms. So the two firms most likely to get involved by the insurance companies when something goes wrong. So this is their data from their own experiences from 2021. So Arite, you'll see here, and I say that because there's an error on the slide. It says $2.3 million in green every single slide down. The 2.3 is meant to be on that first block, and you can just kind of estimate what the lower ones would be. But what it's showing you is quarter over quarter, the amount demanded versus the amount actually paid. So you can tell the demands are always over $1 million. The payouts are in the hundreds of thousands. That's after negotiation. So it starts with a 6-7 figure price tag before we even actually resolve these things. What sectors were impacted? So this slide is going to look pretty similar to the next one. This is all types of cyber incidents. The next one's going to be ransomware, and you're going to see healthcare is here in the second position. This is by Kroll. Kroll actually publishes this data on a monthly basis. The most recent one is for the month of May 2022, so very recent, and it actually still has healthcare as the second most targeted. So that's still the case this year. And I mentioned next slide was going to be same picture, but who's being targeted specifically by ransomware. Healthcare actually fell to third place there. Manufacturing jumped up the ranks. Types of attacks, right? So this is where we talked about zero-day exploits really coming up. So for them to have conducted that ransomware attack, they may have gotten in by exploiting a software vulnerability. And that was the most common exploit in terms of how they were able to infect you and conduct a ransom attack. Otherwise, phishing, right? Taking advantage of folks, getting them to click on a link or an attachment or something that should not have been clicked on. Another interesting look here, and this just shows you that demand versus payout by industry. So if you kind of go just below the middle there as we get to our healthcare block. So average demand for the whole year was 1.3 million and average payout was 330,000. So a couple of predictions for this year, right? We're halfway through the year, and we'll talk a little bit about even some good news at the very end. I promise I'm actually going to wrap this whole thing up a little bit more positive than negative. This is the worst part. We don't know yet what the impact of the Russia-Ukraine war has been, right? Or conflict, I should say. For a period of time, folks were concerned that in order to fund this war that's going on, this conflict, they may conduct more attacks just to recoup money to support themselves financially. There's an alternative school of thought. Because of this conflict, many of the hackers may actually be involved in physical warfare and are not actually actively attacking right now. So perhaps they're less incentivized to be attacking outside of actually one another, both via cyber and actual physical warfare. Kind of different things. We're still figuring out what the impact of that is. I'm really curious to see, hopefully in the next couple of weeks here, the reports for the first half of 2022 and what we're actually seeing there. I mentioned a lot of regulatory attention and pressure on this issue now. And we'll talk a little bit about some of the things that have come out since then. Again, technology advancement, right? We're doing Internet of Things. We're connected, you know, my oven has the ability for me to connect it to my Wi-Fi so that I could remote turn on my oven. Well, if I can remote turn on my oven, that means so could a hacker, right? So the more we do these things, both personally and professionally, we expand that landscape, even including artificial intelligence. And then Arite was one of those other large forensics firms. And so these next three bullets here are actually going to be their predictions from their 2021 report, what would they were anticipating for this year. Because of all the regulatory attention that's really started now, the whole world is looking at ransomware and cyber risk. They do think you're going to see a little less of the public shaming type of attacks, meaning the hackers saying, hey, I'm going to expose everything, or I'm going to call your clients, and a little bit steering away from infrastructure attacks on the United States and other other countries, because they don't want law enforcement coming after them. So there's a lot more intention on this now, so they don't want to be that target. So instead, hey, let me just go for the low-hanging fruit and get my payday and move on. We're going to continue to see, according to Arete, international law enforcement agencies to continue to pressure these actors, right? So you're going to see collaboration across countries. If the hackers are not physically located here, we need collaboration with the countries where they are being housed, and so on and so forth. Making sure that we're looking at collaborating with the private sector. So there's been a lot of meetings this year, even at the White House, with insurance carriers, cybersecurity firms, et cetera, all in the private sector in order to advance and protect the public sector and really all industries at large. And then, of course, I think this was a no-brainer. Threat actors are still going to continue attacking and infecting victims who do not regularly patch, who do not remove unnecessary access, who have not enabled multi-factor authentication, and who have not deployed proper security software.
So it sounds like it's not a if, it's a when folks are going to be hacked and are going to need some sort of protection from these folks who are trying to get into the organization. And I know you said you don't have all bad news, so hopefully the scary part is over. And let's go into the insurance and, you know, risk management standpoint. And I'll preface this by saying, you know, when we talk about insurance and cyber insurance, you know, that should be the last line of defense when bad things happen. And we should be doing other things prior to having to access the aggregate limits of money that we have in our insurance policies to make sure that we're doing all the right things first. So what can we do about all of these threats going forward?
So this is a repeat slide from last year, because how you manage cyber risk has not changed at high level, right? In strategy and philosophy. The physical practices evolve with time in terms of the actual types of technologies and things that we'll use. But at high level, right, it's still a balance of these two things: security, cost, and convenience, and people, process, and technology. So Bob brought up MFA as one of the pieces they deployed. And I know this is something we've all experienced. Even our personal banking accounts offer us MFA now, multi-factor authentication. Before the last 2 years, that didn't fit into the security, cost, convenience triangle, right? We thought that was inconvenient, and it was costly to deploy. And so we chose not to do that. So now that the cycle has moved. So in order for better security, we've now had to shift and say, all right, we needed to spend the money on MFA and tolerate that inconvenience. And now it's become commonplace, right? We expect that, we accept it, and it's just general good practice. So you can kind of see a really good example of how that's constantly shifting and balancing itself. And it'll continue to always shift in time with the latest needs. People, process, and technology. Unfortunately, I'll give you a good example of a process issue, right? So we think about so much with cyber risk being technology focused. Well, technology's goal at the end of the day is to try to prevent the bad guys from getting in, the bad email from actually landing in your inbox, but it can't stop everything. So we had a senior living organization actually, and this was a social engineering attack, send out $2.4 million to someone who they thought was Sodexo and was not, in fact, Sodexo, their vendor. $2.4 million over three transactions. That was not a technology issue. That was a people and a process issue. They had bad processes in place in terms of validating that the request to change where the payment went was truly authorized and authenticated. And then the people themselves were not trained to do those things. So the technology did not fail. The people in the process piece of it failed. Same thing with Target breach. I always tell this story. The Target data breach back in 2014 happened because of their HVAC vendor. Well, Target had the right technology in place. They had the intrusion detection system. The intrusion detection system detected the intruder. They did not review the alert and they did not act on the alert by that system. They failed on the people and the process side of things. So we don't beat cyber risk. We don't manage cyber risk just by buying more technology. You still have to put sound processes, procedures, and people around that. And then, Raf, you mentioned it, insurance, right? So we're insurance brokers by trade. That's just one piece of cyber risk management, but it's a critical piece. When we look back at those slides at the trends and say, these were the average demands versus the payouts, no one's accruing for that. That's not in our balance sheet right now. And we're going, all right, we think we might pay out a ransom in the next year. So let's set $330,000 aside. So that's why we buy insurance, for that financial risk transfer. And we'll talk a lot more about what that looks like today. At the end of the day, your goal is not to be cyber secure. There's no such thing. It is to be cyber resilient, to detect, protect your organization and respond and recover from an attack. Recovery is key. Resilience. We want to be able to bounce back if and when something happens. And then, of course, there's an ever-moving reasonableness standard. If you found yourself in court under a regulatory investigation or a class action lawsuit, you are being held to a reasonableness standard. What was reasonable to expect of my organization? What should we have had in place preventatively? And what should we have done reactionary?
And Alexandra, I know you see in the chat, but just want to flag that Stephanie sheeted, and it sounds like we're going to get to this, but yeah, highlighting, suggesting education strategies for staff to teach protection related to social engineering tactics.
All right, I will come back to that in a little bit. Thank you for pointing that out. I appreciate it. I did miss that because a couple came in since then. Supply chain risk, really big, scary thought right now in cyber. What happens if Amazon Web Services goes down? So many organizations depend on that and are hosting their cloud services, right? That's just an example of an IT cloud. An IT vendor. But what about your non-IT vendors? So I mentioned Sodexo. I'm sure many of you work with an organization like a Sodexo. What happens if they suffer an attack and we don't receive our services from them? So there's exposure within our supply chain, both from our IT and our operational dependencies. And so this is going to sound elementary, but I realize it's much harder in practice to do. It's impossible to always keep up with all the contracts and the vendors and the things that we're doing, but it's a really important step. Understanding who is in our supply chain, who are our vendors, and then what do they have access to? Whether it's Target's HVAC vendor who had actual access to their network because that's how they had to operate the facilities. And then how are we controlling that access? And then of course the devil's in the details, and Raf being a former attorney appreciates this, right? We look at contracts and we have to say, what's in it? Who's responsible when something goes wrong? What insurance did we require everyone to carry? And what do we agree to maintain in terms of confidentiality?
That's a good point. You know, I would encourage everyone to re-review the contracts, both with their counsel and internally, because there have been many instances where we've done that iteration for the insurance aspects of a specific contract, ultimately realizing that, for example, damages are limited to the cost of services provided by that IT vendor, where you're paying this guy maybe 10, 20 grand to do the work, and the exposure is in the millions. I go back to the, downtime. Aspects, so really take that time to review your contracts to ensure that the indemnity provisions and the risk transfer provisions would contain there are properly set up.
So cyber insurance, we're gonna get insurance here for a couple minutes, but I promise I will try to keep it interesting. And I will tell you,
I'm excited.
I think most people are not actually that clear on what cyber insurance covers. So really, really high level, but I'm gonna get into this in a little more detail in a few slides. So it covers incident response, regulatory investigations and lawsuits, various aspects of cyber crime, our interruption to our business, our overall profit and any extra expenses we incur, and overall the damage to our reputation. So what that actually looks like in practice is that cyber insurance policies are a little unique in that they include both first party coverages, so for damages to yourself, myself, and then third party, damages I cause to others. So it has both on these policies, right? We think about property insurance, properties just for our own property. We buy professional liability insurance because of damages we may cause to a third party. This is actually both all on the same program. First party coverages include, as I said, incident response, right? So typically this is going to be your forensics and your breach coach, which is legal, your attorney. Notification costs, credit monitoring, call centers. And if you need it, if you end up as one of the folks I talk about in these presentations, there's a very good chance you probably need public relations to navigate an incident like that. I will tell you, not always is public relations involved. Typically, these events can be contained enough that we don't involve PR. But if it's really something that's catastrophic, it's possible that you would need to. All of those are intended to be part of kind of incident response. I talked about cybercrime, right? So the actual payment of a ransom is intended to be covered by cyber insurance. And then you're going to see, this is the beauty of the insurance world that Raf and I live every day. So there's something sometimes called funds transfer fraud or computer fraud. Those could be the same thing. And that's really the idea that someone hacks into your system and steals from you, all right? So they stole from you versus funds transfer fraud / social engineering, so also sometimes called the same thing, which is really the idea that you voluntarily parted with it. And you did it under false pretense, right? You were being defrauded into believing somebody was not who they said they were, right? You thought there was somebody you could trust, a vendor, so-and-so, and it was not who they said they were, but you did voluntarily part with that. Those are different things in the insurance world. There's also something called service fraud and telecom fraud. That's the idea that they utilize any of your services, traditionally your internet capacity, your audio conferencing services, to commit fraud, whether it's to mine for cryptocurrency. They could steal your processing power and your next your utility invoices come back way off the charts. Or I actually lived this one time at my old company. We actually had our conferencing service compromised and made thousands of dollars of charges internationally because our conferencing service was compromised. Continuing with first party, business interruption and extra expense. So this is analogous to property insurance. You have business interruption and extra expense coverage on your property policy. And that's for that time that you're down and rebuilding after some form of property loss. Same idea. This is covering you for while you're down during a cyber incident. It also may include dependent business interruption. So if you're dependent on a hosted IT provider and you suffer loss because they are down, or if you are dependent upon someone else within your supply chain and you're suffering loss because they are down, it does not always have to be IT, and it depends on how the insurance policy is written, and we'll get into that. And then there's something called reputational harm. It's a continuing business interruption coverage for when you're back up and operational, but you are still suffering loss. So you've lost consumers, clients, patients, and they don't return after you're back up and operational. That would be considered continuing loss in the form of reputational harm. So it's going to continue to protect your balance sheet. The cost of actually restoring your system. So if you lose records as a result of your backups weren't good, you need to recreate them, or they were corrupted, or you end up just losing them in some capacity, they'll actually cover the cost of having to restore those things. If you need to replace physical equipment because it was bricked, is the term, which means it was rendered as useful as a brick. You can throw that piece of equipment at somebody, but that's about as useful as it is. No longer is it a technological device. That's called bricking, and there's coverage for those devices in the event that occurs. And then an important piece is betterment. We'll talk a little bit about that in a bit, but essentially, technology advances so quickly. Do you want to buy, if your 2008 server is the one that gets bricked, do you want to buy a 2008 server today? Likely not, right? We want something more efficient and more secure. But insurance indemnifies you by trade to where you were before a loss. So it's intended to only cover you up to the value of that 2008 server, unless you have betterment coverage. Betterment gives you a cushion to buy the more advanced version of that piece of technology. Third-party coverages, and there's only one slide on this. We're almost through some of the insurance pain here. So network security and privacy liability, depending on the insurance carrier, they group these together or they split them out. Essentially, if you cause damage to someone else's network, or if you compromise someone else's privacy and they suffer loss, whether it's dictated by law or they actually suffer identity theft in some way, it's your liability to others because of those types of events. big concern really more than anything is a regulatory investigation. So when we're talking about healthcare organizations, and I do see some things going on in the chat here, and I'll check it in a minute. When we talk about regulatory investigations, and you guys are in the healthcare space, HIPAA is a big one. And the interesting thing is when you think about cyber incidents, we think about the cost of resolving that incident when it's happening. The regulatory piece comes later. They come and they do an investigation, right? Not that much different than OSHA. It's after the fact they're investigating and they're going to assign a fine or penalty. And it could be a couple of years later, and that those things can have a long tail to them. And if you owe money because you're fined or penalized, that's actually third-party coverage. Media liability is something they throw into cyber policies. It's actually the idea of defamation, IP infringement, libel, slander, disparagement, really through your media, so your content, your websites, your marketing materials. That's actually thrown into to cyber policies. And then PCI, if you are charging, if you're using credit cards and accepting credit card payments, you could get brought into a PCI regulatory investigation. So fines or penalties there would be prompted.
So it's interesting, you know, how the hackers, as we've been saying over and over, are getting more and more intelligent. So too are the insurance markets who are providing this coverage. And I think Bob alluded to this at the very beginning, is that, you know, when he was, you know, entering into the renewal process, he was getting ready for a hefty increase, as well as maybe some potential changes in coverage. And that's the thing, I think, where we really set ourselves apart, in that the insurance market, the insurance carriers are never going to come to us and say, here's your renewal quote. Oh, by the way, take a look at page 98, where we just changed all the exclusionary language within the policy to now provide less coverage. They're not going to announce that to us. It's our job as the broker to review the policy and to ensure that we're keeping up with the protection that's needed for our clients. And, you know, that's happens is that the carriers are typically going to be changing around the language within the policy to try to stay ahead of, you know, whether or not they want to pay out a loss down the road. And to Alexandra's credit, one of the really, you know, great things that she's been doing over the last couple of years is really tearing apart those cyber policies during the renewal process. One that we have clients who come to us, or prospective clients who come to us and say, take a look at my cyber policy and tell me how I stand. A lot of times we find some pretty big flaws and big holes in the coverage that's being provided. So Alexandra, I can't imagine things are just going to stay stagnant as we go forward. What's changing out there in the cyber landscape from just a review sort of standpoint when it comes to what they're purchasing from a cyber standpoint?
Yes, I will get into that momentarily. Sheila, I want to thank you for your input, saying you've had spoofing emails, even sent a text, and that you're always worried about employees falling victim to the Amazon gift card scheme. And I will tell you, JKJ fell victim to that in the form of our interns. Our summer interns 2 summers ago did fall victim to that exact thing. They got the emails. The email said, text this number. They texted the number, and the number, you know, all purporting to be our president at the time. And they went out and bought some gift cards. So none of us are immune to these types of things. And that is very common. And it really taught me a lesson that not only do I need to worry about our employees, but I really need to make sure I'm giving this same conversation and training to our interns. They're just as culpable. And the crazy thing about that story is we had 11 interns that summer. 4 of them received the emails. 2 started texting. Only 1 actually acted on it. And I was so fascinated why only 4 received it. And it was the same 4 that changed on LinkedIn and said they were interning. The others did not. And that was how they were targeted. So it's crazy how things work. So,
I was going to say also you'll find that a lot of the execs at our clients' organizations are the ones who are the bad actors too. The CEO, the CFO, the person who's so busy, he or she is just clicking on the link, saying yes to this email. They're typically the bad actors too. And so when we're doing our sort of fire drill exercises, we have to go up to the highest rank and say, hey, you're the one that's opening up the hole here for the organization. So it can be anybody as far as, you know, who's causing the problems.
Yes. So what's changing? These are all articles from July of last year. So we saw significant rate increases all throughout 2021. And if you were successful in avoiding it in the onset of 2021, you felt it at the onset of 2022. So major double digit to triple digit increases. This is continuing in some capacity this year. So we are still seeing double digit increases, but not to the same extent. So instead of from 60 to 80%, we're down to the 30 to 40%. Still significant percentage-wise, but I will say, fortunately, more often than not, cyber insurance is not your biggest dollar insurance policy. So dollars-wise, hopefully not an extraordinary impact. You even heard Bob giving the numbers of their story, right? So technically, it was still over 20% that increase, but dollars-wise, it was not as extraordinary as we had originally anticipated had they not implemented so many cybersecurity protocols. So Raf, you mentioned, you know, adequacy of limits, right? So how do we even know if we're buying enough insurance? So a big part of our consultation is, hey, this is what it could look like if you had an incident. And I use multiple data breach calculators. I don't like to just use one because they're all pulling from different data sources. So I use multiple to come up with a range. So this one might say that you have a $6.6 million potential, and another might say, hey, it's more like 3.7. So I might conclude we would be most comfortable buying 4 to 5 million in limits. That, hey, we don't necessarily have to buy the most insurance in the world. You can go broke buying insurance, and that's not necessary. So let's figure out what's our happy medium based off of our risk profile. But you have to give thought to those things. And I would tell you, if you're an organization on this call that's still only buying $1 million of cyber coverage, that is inadequate for a healthcare related organization. Healthcare and human services, 1 million is insufficient. Things that are changing, they're starting to get away from offering limits inside or outside of the aggregate. So you may buy an aggregate. The better policies offer you some breach response or other services outside of that, and some are more contained within. From a retroactive date standpoint, these are all claims made coverages. You want full prior acts. There's really no reason to have a retro date on a cyber policy. The insurance markets are happy to not have one, which means they give you full prior acts. Essentially, what this means is if you have a retroactive date of July 1st, 2022, and it turns out that you actually had a compromise back in May, you didn't really know about it, but it gets exploited in August, there's the potential they could decline that claim because it fell before your retroactive date. So we want to be careful with those things. Is your regulatory coverage written broadly enough, right? There's so many evolving regulations. You want it written in a way that's going to accommodate them as they change, as opposed to having to be endorsed on. So that's something you need to keep an eye out for. The big one is extortion. Unfortunately, more and more and more I'm seeing pullbacks in coverage here, and that usually comes in the form of coinsurance, high deductibles, or just less limit. So maybe you're buying a $3 million cyber policy and they're giving you $500,000 for extortion, or you're buying a $3 million cyber policy and they're giving you a 50% coinsurance penalty, which means whatever we pay, you pay half. So in order for you to actually get the $3 million of extortion coverage, you would have to pay out an extortion demand of $6 million because they're only covering up to half. So to have fully utilized that full $3 million, your demand would have to have been six. Social engineering, they're continue to pull back on, right? So unfortunately, you know, insurance companies don't actually love paying claims. It's not their favorite thing to do. They love collecting premium and not paying claims. So the more they've been paying on these social engineering attacks, the more they're pulling back on this coverage, which was really in the form of sublimits. You cannot get millions of dollars of coverage for that. There is something to keep an eye out for, which is whether or not it's relevant to your business. There's something called reverse social engineering, which is sometimes named invoice manipulation or push payment fraud. This is the idea that someone purports to be your organization and fools somebody else. And as a result of that, you now can't receive money that you were actually maybe due legitimately from that individual. You can collect that receivable under your cyber policy. So make sure that if that's relevant, you have coverage for that. Couple uncommon coverages. Some policies will offer coverage for theft of personal funds of executives, or if someone purports to be your organization, files a PPP loan in the form of corporate identity theft. Business interruption and extra expense. I mentioned I would come back to this. So if you are an organization that is highly dependent upon cloud service providers, you are not on premise at all, you have a major dependent exposure. You're not in control of those network components. You're not in control of that. That's not within your responsibility. So if something happens to them and it impacts you, make sure you look at your policy to see the dependent or contingent business interruption limit. Oftentimes it is less than the policy limit now. And that's because the carriers are saying, hey, I didn't underwrite them. I didn't look at their cyber application. I underwrote you and your cyber risk. I don't know what they're doing. So I'm not going to cover that the same way I would cover you. You can get full limits, and it's something that's really important the more you advance and move things to the cloud. That also holds true for non-IT providers as well. System failure may or may not be included in your policy, and it's something to look out for. So that's the idea of it. It wasn't a hack. It wasn't some crazy attack that happened. Our system crapped out in some way. Somebody kicked the plug out of the wall and it took us 3 days to figure it out. Whatever the cause of the system failure becomes irrelevant. You just want coverage for interruption to your business if that occurs. So even broader than just true cyber attacks. Reputational harm, something to keep in mind and make sure that you're considering the limit on that and the period of indemnity. System restoration. So we talked a little bit about bricking. You want to make sure you have betterment on there. I'm going to move quickly here because we're coming up against the hour. For healthcare organizations, you want contingent bodily injury coverage in the event that somebody gets injured as a result of a cyber attack on your organization. That could be excluded by your other policy. So it's something that you do want to have endorsed onto your cyber program. They also have similar endorsements for property and pollution. You want to make sure your policy is written on a duty to defend form, that it is the duty of the insurance company to step in and defend you. There are policies that do not have this language, which means it's on you until that you prove that it's covered, and then they'll step in and help you. Same idea with pay on behalf of or reimbursement policies. If you have to pay a $330,000 crypto ransom, do you want to front that money and have to reimburse the carrier? Or do you want them to pay on behalf of you? You want pay on behalf. Really, really important. Also keep an eye out some other key things that are coming. Stipulations around how you handle a breach or a ransomware event. When was it discovered? How did you disclose it? Did you start negotiating without permission? Chubb has a couple of really ugly endorsements now. If you have a Chubb policy, be very cautious. One is called neglected software exploitation. It's essentially the idea of if you didn't patch something timely, they start reducing your limits over the period of time that you haven't patched it. After 45 days, your limits are dropping 5%. After 60 days, they're dropping 10%. After 90 days, they're dropping 50%. And it's just your limits keep dropping the longer you went without patching something that was known, known by the world, not known by you. There's also specific event and widespread event exclusion. So like I said, they actually have an exclusion. If Amazon went down, they're not covering you. They've written that into their policies now. Most carriers don't have that. With the Ukrainian and Russian conflict, it's really brought up a lot of conversation around terrorism and war exclusion. So all insurance policies by definition tend to exclude war and terrorism. Most cyber policies will have a cyber terrorism carve back. So make sure that that's included on your policy. And then this article here, is from this week. Travelers wants out of contract with insured that allegedly misrepresented MFA use. So they're denying a claim because of the warranty of using your application, your application you completed as a warranty. And if you misrepresent something, they will deny coverage. And we're seeing more and more in that. I know we're coming up, we have 5 minutes here. So any questions, yes, please type them in.
Let's do this, Alexandra. Why don't we, can we jump ahead to the, you know, what can we do going forward? I mean, Stephanie threw a good softball up as far as educating staff and doing all that stuff. Let's jump into there.
Yeah, two quick things on the slide. Keep an eye on ransomware. It might become illegal to pay it. North Carolina just made it illegal for any government agency to negotiate with hackers. And Pennsylvania and New York are currently considering following suit and even extending that to private industry. The federal government came out with an updated cyber incident reporting law for critical infrastructure that was passed in March. So it's going to come into effect over the next 2 years. And it's going to define how quickly you need to notify the government if something happens. How can we prepare? So I'm going to skip through these things. And these are all of the things that we would go through if we did an investigation of your organization. This is exactly what we reviewed with Bob. So I will assess where you fall against these things. These are required by the insurance companies many times now, and it varies by the size of your organization, exactly which are absolutely required versus nice to have, but really, really important stuff here. A cyber risk assessment could look something like this. An incident, just so you know, in terms of who would be involved, you, your IT, whether in-house or out-house, your insurance, your legal, forensics, and potentially the FBI. Your broker would be involved in certain areas, public relations might be involved, and the FBI may or may not be involved. And you can read through kind of what those roles are, and I'll get those slides over to you. And things to think about in managing an incident. Biggest pieces is, how are you communicating internally, externally, and who's involved in those decisions? So managing an incident, you have to actually contain it, go through all the process of figuring out what happened, how it happened, stop the bleeding, recover. Then who do I need to comply with, whether legal or even supply chain obligations? Look at your contracts. You may actually owe somebody notification that you had a breach, do lessons learned. And for takeaways, Raf, right? Review your cybersecurity posture, review your coverage, go through an incident response planning exercise, conduct a tabletop exercise. I know Bob's team did that in the last year. And for some cautiously optimistic news, cyber criminals are finally more likely to get caught than ever. We're actually even starting to see a little bit of a dip in cyber attacks. So for mobile devices, that's a little bit down. Ransomware was down in the first quarter of this year. And then because of that, we're seeing a little bit of a softening in the insurance pricing, no longer triple digit pricing.
And kudos to Bob for, you know, bringing up the fact that it's, you know, a great idea to just jump all over it now. Your renewal might be next summer, but let's start the process now. I think I put in the chat room feature there that, you know, part of our relationship with Lutheran Services in America allows us the opportunity to offer a complimentary analysis of your current cyber insurance. And what we do is we confidentially review that with you, your team, and us, and we sit down and we identify where the holes are, where things might need to be tweaked, enhanced, fixed, so that the coverage is as robust as possible, and so that you're best positioned for the next renewal, similar to what we did for Bob and his team. So with all of that, I know we have 2 minutes to go. Again, Charlotte, thank you so much for all of you and your team to help us get this over the finish line. And we will kick it over to you now.
Great. Thank you. So I think the conclusion is, don't be scared, be prepared. Right?
There it is.
There you go. There you go.
So thank you to everybody who's joined us today for the session. Thank you, Alexandra. Thank you, Raphael. You, as mentioned before, Kim Roque will be sending out a copy of all the slides, information on contacting Raphael, as well as the recording. And please stay tuned for a few additional strength and service series that are coming up. In fact, next week, July 20th at 1 p.m. Eastern Time, Dr. Monica Cox will present on moving from ally to accomplice, exploring what it means to do real diversity work. And then on August 4th at 2 p.m. Eastern Time, Ziegler will be offering a leadership roundtable for senior leaders on navigating choppy waters, a leadership discussion on financial pressures and innovative practices. Please look to our website, lutheranservices.org, and sign up for those sessions as well. And thank you again to everybody. Have a great afternoon.
Take care.
Thank you all.